What's up, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Dance and Talks, the podcast released from a live story Amsterdam. I'm Teresa Allen, aka Teaser, and I'm your host, as I have the honor to interview dancers from all over the world with different dance styles. I'm trying to make every single interview and episode unique so that you and I can get fruitful conversations out of every dancer and listening to their stories. Today is no exception, as I'm interviewing one of the biggest female artists within the salsa, bachata, and the kizomba scene. This woman has not only one style, but active in three different styles. She has hundreds of thousands of followers and are inspiring women all over the planet in order to gain more style, more expressions, and more dance joy. Today, I'm interviewing the one and only Sara Panero. Si te digo que te amo, que tu amor me tiene enfermo, te aproveché con más ganas, me das lo que quiero. Aunque te vendas como ángel, oficial tiene esos trucos, y es por eso que hace tiempo yo no duermo solo. Es que me enamoró, con su carita de inocente, ya me enamoró. Es una diabla bien vestida, ya me enamoró. Hace todo lo que pide, ya me enamoró. Te digo que te amo, que tu amor me tiene enfermo. Te aproveché con más ganas, me das lo que quiero. Aunque te vendas como ángel, oficial tiene esos trucos. Y es por eso que hace tiempo yo no duermo solo. Ya yo no duermo solo. So here are some things you should know about Sara. She was born and raised in Salamanca, 2 hours from Madrid, the capital of Spain. Sara started to dance as a 7-year-old, but always had a love for dance. She took multiple styles as ballet, modern, jazz, hip-hop, and many more. As a 16-year-old, Sara competed for the first time, and we're gonna ask her all about it. Later on, Sara found the Latin dance styles of salsa and bachata, and quickly became in both dance groups and couples as she started to compete within these styles. A lot of people know Sara from the style of Kizomba as well, as she became a partner of Albert and toured around the world with him for years. Now, Sara is running her own online boot camps and collaborations all over the world with different dance artists, and we are gonna ask all about it in this interview. But first, you already know what to do. Click that like button, share, comment, give us a rating. And if you're new to this podcast, thank you so much for finding the tribe. And if you are a loyal listener, thank you again. And don't forget to share this episode with a friend. I hope you enjoy it. And now, let's get it going. Welcome to this interview, Sara Panero. Where in the world are you located right now?
Actually, I'm in Madrid, Spain. I'm Spanish, but from a small city, 2 hours away from here. And actually, I can't wait to go there because we can't for the moment. And I can't wait to see my father, my grandmother, you know. And we're still waiting to have the permission of the president, you know, to travel.
To go outside your home. Yeah. So your home time is Salamanca. Is that how I pronounce it? Yeah.
Yeah. Salamanca.
And how big is that city? What kind of city is it?
It's small, but it's pretty famous because we have the first university in Europe. So yeah, it's the oldest one. And a lot of students go every year to study the career in my city. So yeah, but I moved to Madrid with 18 years old.
So then you actually lived there quite your entire life, childhood or teenager years. Can you tell me like about a favorite memory you have from Salamanca growing up there?
You know, Salamanca is, the people from there, we are really similar, the character, and we love the city, but we know everyone that the opportunities there are not many. So, but I have a lot of beautiful memories with my friends in my, you know, when I started dancing. And, you know, all that I was doing was dancing. But, you know, I have a lot of friends that I still have relation with them now from my city. So that's pretty cool. And it's a beautiful city. So I recommend everyone to go and visit. Yeah, that's, and it's so really nice. There is a lot of, you know, green zones and a lot of natural spaces and you know, you eat really good in there. So.
Oh, okay, that's good to know.
Yeah.
That's so cool. And you started to dance in the age of 7, if I understood it right. And you've been dancing a lot of different styles. What was it that caught you with dancing? Why didn't you become a soccer player or a basketball player?
You know, I tried a lot of things when I was a kid. Actually, I played basketball.
Oh, really?
And I was doing swimming as well. And, you know, but that was, I was really, really like, I don't know, 5, 6 years old. And then I actually, like 1 or 2 weeks ago, my father told me that my version was not the right one because I thought my mom bring me to the dance school they opened close to her work. And my father told me, that's not right. You ask to go to the school. We were, you know, walking there and you say, oh, I want to dance. I want to go to dance classes. Please, mom, bring me here. Blah, blah, blah. So it was me, actually. I even knew that because I was really, really, really small with 7. But I have some memories being really, 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 a kid, like really, really small, dancing, you know, moving with the music, not dancing because maybe I didn't knew actually what was dance at that time, but moving, you know, always with the music and you know, stretching and all the things, even if I didn't knew what I was doing. But yeah, I was always enjoying the music because my mom always, my mom loves music. And she was always at home playing music and I was, you know, moving.
That is so cute. I think that is so funny to know, like, see children when they're expressing dance and like how different that can look like. I can totally relate to what you're saying because my biggest wish was to dance in a pink bathing suit on a trampoline. And like, that was dancing for me to whatever music that was. So... I think that is so cool. And I think I find it so interesting to see like when dancers have that urge from their very young to do this passion.
Yeah.
That's really nice. That's really nice.
And that's things that I never thought before, but I'm now like, how everything started, because I know I started taking classes with 7, but before I remember, you know, my parents going to the, they were used to go to the gym and they had to bring me with them because they didn't have anyone to let me with. And I was, you know, in a corner dancing, you know, with 3 or 4 years. And it's like, you know, I could be sitting and not doing nothing, but I was dancing. So that's interesting.
Yeah, for sure. And then you tried all these dance styles. And I also saw that you competed your first time when you were 16 in like a couple competition, all style, and you won.
Yeah.
Tell me about that. What was that, your first experience of competing? Was that something where you like, oh, I like competing, because you've been doing it ever since?
Yeah, you know, the thing of the styles, from when I started, I, you know, in that school, you go and you say, okay, my daughter has 7 years old and she wants to take dance classes. Okay, so there they gave you the opportunity to choose, I don't know, different disciplines, different styles. But my mom put me in one option that was, for example, Mondays ballet and Wednesdays modern, you know, like modern dance for kids, you know. So I started like that. So from the very beginning, I was doing 2 different styles. I was never doing just one style. So when I grew up, I started watching hip hop and, you know, funky, we call it at that time. And because there was at that moment, there was a really famous program here in Spain called FAMA. And the winner of the first edition was from my city. So, you know, it was everything involved. And so I met, you know, the dance hall and the house and the hip hop and, you know, I had friends also doing, you know, popping and all the stuff. That's not my style at all, but I like it.
But you know it. You know it. That's great.
By the way. But, you know, so, and I was also taking contemporary classes and still ballet, you know, so I liked to try different things because it's like the music. I don't like just one style of music. So if I like, for example, 3, 6, 10 different music styles, I cannot dance everything like I dance the others. So it was kind of related to that. And it was nice because I was actually enjoying the different energies or the different steps to learn the dance in the different styles. So I liked it because when you go up to a hip hop class and a ballet class is totally different stuff. So I like that. I like that.
Yeah.
And with 17, I had a friend at that time. Well, actually, he's still my friend and he lives in Madrid also. And we saw this competition and we say, okay, so we can go together because we like more or less the same styles. And we say, okay, what we can do to have more options to win the competition. And, you know, there was a salsa couple, there was a hip hop couple, there was a, I don't know, contemporary couple, but we thought maybe anyone's going to do a lot of different styles. So we did that and it was like a surprise, no? Because everyone was or more urban or more classical or more Latin, but anyone mixed everything. So we did it and people liked it.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. You won. Yes.
Yeah, we won. But you know, that was a competition like really.
Yeah. but it was the evening when you celebrated that competition that salsa came into your life. So yes, it maybe was that the point of that winning that competition.
Yeah, definitely. It was the point and it was really funny because I was like just joking, you know, we were like, oh, let's have a dinner and we go to dance somewhere, you know, with our friends, and just joking, we go to a salsa bar and there, you know, guys asked me to dance and I was like, I don't know how to dance, like salsa. I know how to do a choreography, but I don't know how to dance salsa. And they were like, no, you just follow me, you know, like doesn't matter, you just enjoy. And one guy told me, no, but you really, like, you can follow and everything. And if you want, you can come to my classes. I teach every Fridays or whatever in this bar, you know. And I started going to salsa classes. Was like that. Like, okay, let's go.
It's funny because sometimes you don't understand, like, what a moment in your life can result if somebody would have seen you that evening celebrating your all style couple win, knowing that you would like tour the whole world with these styles later on. So it's really amazing to look back and like see when did the switch happen. So what have you then been taking from the other styles into your Latin dances, the salsa, bachata, and the later kizomba? From the hip hop and the modern, do you feel like you have certain skills that you always kept with you?
Yes. I mean, with the years, you develop even more your qualities, no? Let's say the musicality, the body movement, whatever it is. But I think the different way of listening to music, that was the hip hop that gave me a different view of it. And also, everyone, like, any person that watched me dancing can see that I am a ballet dancer because of the posture of the lines or whatever. And that will, you know, that are my two bases. And I think to be versatile, you say in English?
Versatile
is something that I didn't plan to be. But it was natural for me and it helped me a lot because, you know, more things you do, it's like life. You know, more things you do, it will be easier to learn other one, for example, languages or sports or dance or whatever. So I just, you know, I just wanted to learn everything I could, and I try to keep that still today.
So. Yeah, for sure. And you also took your dancing even further. You went to the Conservatory of Dance Fortuna.
Yes. You prepared.
Yes, yeah, for sure. And I have never been to a classical education myself. I went to my hip-hop education, so I can just imagine it's very different. Do you have any like very strong memory from those 3 years you spent it in that school?
That for sure were my hardest years in my life. The hardest years in my life, no doubt. Because I can say the people that was at any time in the conservatory, they can understand what you feel. Otherwise, it's really difficult to imagine because you have a lot of pressure, you have a lot of people, a lot of restrictions, and also it's a competition every day. Like you, even if you're not really competitive, but it is like that, you know? And I was so tired, like so tired, because it's 4 hours a day. I remember one day that, you know, I was working at night in salsa bars, you know, dancing. Yes. And wow. I had the conservatory at in the afternoon the first 2 years. But one Thursday, you know, you were at the party and everything goes like, you know, till really late. I gone home, I slept for, I don't know, 2-3 hours, and I go to the conservatory. I couldn't lift my leg. I couldn't. It was like so heavy. I was in front of the mirror, you know, and trying to do this with my leg, you know, on the side. I was like, I can't. It's like, you have to be, you have to eat good. You have to, you know, everything you do is related to that. You know, to the ballet, to be a ballet dancer, to think like a ballet dancer is like, is a lot of stress, a lot. And, you know, people is like, oh, but you have a lot of discipline and all this stuff. And I say, you know, if you arrive to the conservatory and it's one more minute and you're not in the class, you don't enter, you know, it's like that. Or if you have the, you know, the, I don't know.
The hair bun. Yeah, the bun, yeah.
Good. They can expulse you from the class, or you know, that kind of stuff. So you don't have option, you know. You have to learn how to do things like that. But even if it was hard, I'm really thankful for that moment and for my teachers and everything, because I learned a lot that serves me after for what I'm doing now and also in my life.
The work discipline must come straight from there. Yes. Yeah. That's amazing.
No doubt. Yeah.
And I also know that you like, okay, so we're jumping quite fast here because you have so many years of dancing, but you went into the Latin dance of salsa and bachata, and you became a part of a crew, Esencia.
Mm-hmm.
Esencia. What did it mean for you to go from, you know, being a solo dancer into a crew? How did it change you in that way?
You know, before that, I started dancing in capo, in Kizomba and Bachata, and the group was easy, but the partnership was, you know, different way of working, because you have to meet someone to train, you have to, in somehow, you depend on that person. And I was not used to do that. So that was the big change and the big difference. But after the group, it was almost the same, you know, technique or the same way to do it. The only thing is, more people you put inside, normally more problems or more difficulties, because, you know, agree with one or two or three people is kind of easy. But more people, not all the time. And, you know, if one arrives late, you know, you have to wait. And, you know, you also are part of a group, if I remember that. And it's difficult.
Yeah. And you had several, so let's switch the focus to the partners then, because mm-hmm. your partners, you haven't had one, you have had yeah. several different partners, and it can almost be like chapters of your life, because I think that when you're with somebody, it changes yeah. you a little bit. How do you see, how has these chapters been for you? And have you seen like a development within you being with different people?
You know, it's exactly like that. When I started dancing with Marco and competing with him, I was 19. Hmm. So I was a baby, you know, a baby in this bachata world and kizomba and salsa. And so I was learning. That was my, you know, my learning chapter. And you know, and developing something, but mainly learning how to work in couple, how to, you know, to work to compete or to reach your goals, because it's not the same to want to be an international teacher than compete. It's different thing, you know. After, I would say with Albir, I will jump a little bit because it was a really, really different for me. Difference. With Albir, let's say I was more mature, but not enough. Mm. I learned you know, a little bit more about the business, because you, when you're competing, you're not thinking about, oh, I need to negotiate with the organizers. No, you're thinking, I need to train and take, you know, acrobatic classes and be better than this and this and this, because I need to win, sorry. And after, if you win, maybe someone calls you and, you know, and you try to, but it's really different thing, different way of thinking. And with Albir, it was more like work. You know, it is not anymore a hobby. It is not anymore, I don't know, something that you were thinking to do or not. No, it's really every weekend, I don't know, different countries every weekend, different people. And I really thought, I really felt that I, you know, did a step more personally. And professional, mm-hmm. but personally as well.
You had to grow up quick.
yes. Yeah. And many people tell me, oh, but you are, I don't know, when I was 24, you're 24, but you think like 27, 28. And I say, because I have to, you know, I have to push me, or I experience things that you know, made me on that way. So, but was nice, because I was prepared for things that maybe I shouldn't be prepared if I didn't have that people by my side, or, you know, that kind of things.
Yeah. And you are kind of one of the, why I think it's so interesting to interview you is because you didn't let go of the salsa and bachata just because you went into kizomba, because people tend to, like, you know, now I'm gonna all in for this style, but you have managed somehow to keep these styles all very active. Yeah. So I wonder, like, are you a different dancer, personality or character within these styles? Or are you like the same in these styles? When you like dance, when you express yourself, of course the music is different, we have a different feeling, but you as a dancer, do you feel like you have like three different Sara Paneros?
No. I think I'm the same, but I'm just dancing different on different music and different style. I'm the same. Yeah, definitely. But you know, I always felt, for example, when I was dancing with Albi, I was missing bachata, you know, and salsa. When I was doing more salsa, I was missing bachata and kizomba. You know, it was always like that. And all the time, I was always trying to, you know, still go to ballet classes or take some hip-hop classes. Not every week, because it was impossible. It is impossible right now. But, you know, every month or two, or, you know, but it makes me feel good. It makes me feel that I still can do that, you know. I didn't lose that. So it's good.
Yeah.
It's good to feel that.
Yeah, because then you keep true to yourself and who you are, but you're just having different influences.
Yeah.
So then I want to switch it up and say then, like, you have had different partners in different styles.
Yeah.
Do you see a similarity between these leaders? Is it something of a personality trait that you're like, oh, I like to dance with these type of leaders, no matter what style?
I would say that all my partners, they were really passionate about what they were doing, and they were like, if they have to choose something like a quality as a dancer, I think all of them, it would be the way to listen to music. That's something that's the most important thing for me, and the one that impressed me the most, I would say. Because good technique is, I won't say easy, but it's easier to get. But a different way to listen to music, I think it's something really particular, really personal, and really difficult. And that, I love that when I see someone different or someone surprising me. And that's what really, I love that.
Yeah, but it comes mostly from the musicality.
Yes.
Yes. That's nice. And you're also one of the female artists in the scene that I really feel do both solo shows and couple shows. Not everyone is doing solo shows. Yeah. What do you prefer? Do you have any preferences of like, do you like to perform alone?
I will say being a bit lazy. that for me is more comfortable when I dance with Marco, because or with my partner, because he, you know, we help each other, and you know, the responsibility is in both of us. Also, I do perform solos, but not that much as I perform in couple. So maybe I feel more comfortable performing in couple. And you know, before going on the stage, when you are with someone, you support each other, like, hey, it's gonna be okay, it's gonna be good, do your best, blah blah. But when you are by yourself, it's like, you know, like anyone's going to hit me, so I have to do that myself, you know. It's a hard moment. And also, I was talking on the interview, rehearsal by yourself alone in a room is so hard. People can't imagine. It's like, oh my God. That a lot of respect for the people that does that, because it's really, really something. I would say the most difficult things in this.
Yeah, because if you're a dancer that, like, at least I do, I feed off of energy. So if I don't have anyone in the studio, it's really hard for me to source energy.
Have to push yourself, and you have to say to yourself, let's go, you need to do this. You know, if you're with someone, it could happen that one day, both of you are, you know, a little bit down or something, but it's really strange, you know, at least one of both, you know, and you say, let's go, forget that, and let's work or whatever. But by yourself, what do you do? It's like you talk with yourself or what? It's really complicated. It is.
And so do you have any like secrets before you go on stage, or you know, before you do demo, that is like mentally Sara Panero preparing for show type of moments?
Before, when I'm alone, I get really nervous, but I don't show. Like, I'm nervous inside. I just try to calm myself. You know, I'm like concentrating, stretching, just, you know, praying. I don't know. You know, just to feel okay. But something curious is when I step on the stage, it's like, goes away. I come into my personality. I don't feel that, because I feel I'm the same down or on the stage. I just, you know, I'm doing my show, but you know, I just change completely the attitude, you know. Once I step on the stage, it changed everything. And with Marco, and also with Ari, we did that at the moment. We hear each other.
like it's gonna be okay, don't worry, you know. And you know, it's something cyclical that you think if you don't have the other, something is going to happen, you know. So it's like, I need that, even if we argue, even if something is wrong, it doesn't matter.
It's yeah. Like a mandatory hug.
Mandatory. Yeah.
And so you mentioned that you feel like you're the same person on stage and off stage, and you know, mm-hmm. you are obviously very confident to be on stage and doing these solo shows. How has the journey of self-confidence been for you? Because as a dancer, that is a constant journey. Have you ever, was there a moment in your career where you just something clicked and you're like, oh, okay, now I'm here? Or do you have any things that you have to repeatedly do in order to stay confident?
There is two moments that I can remember, and after is not because you or many people watch me doing videos, going on the stage, blah, blah, that I'm 100% confident. It doesn't work like that. You know, I have days, I don't know, last month or 2 months ago, like, you know, you have days that you see something or you feel different and you are not really sure if you are doing the things right, or for some reason you don't feel really good that day, or, you know, I try to don't do it, but sometimes I can't avoid to compare myself with other dancers. And that's normal because we're humans, you know, I think. But there was two moments in my career. One moment, it was when I was 8 years old. I remember I saw myself doing shows and stuff of ballet and different things. I couldn't raise my head. It's like I was dancing, doing everything, but looking to the floor all the time. When I saw that, it was like, why I feel I see myself so strange, and it changed completely my mind, because I was doing all the exercises, all the steps correctly and beautiful, but my face was like, what's wrong with her, you know, like, because I was so shy, I couldn't watch the people in the eyes, you know. I was so shy at that moment. So I learned that. And from there, I started to maybe smile a little bit, dancing, and, you know, but that was really little by little. And when the first adult competition that Marco and I did together, it was improvisation, and we going to the south of Spain. And, you know, at that time, because, you know, Cork and Judith, they are from the south. You know, so they trained people, they had students and everything. And, you know, it was kind of the thought. It was like, if you're not from the South, you don't really know how to dance bachata. Like, ooh, you know, yeah. Or that was the, you know, a little bit the feeling. So when we arrived, Marco and I, we were from Madrid, you know, from the center, more north. And I was even more north, but they didn't know anyway. We came from Madrid. And I felt, you know, the people watching us or looking at us, like, you know, like they're not gonna do nothing, you know, nothing special or nothing, you know. And, you know, that touched me so much, like, why? Like, I can't do that, you know, like, and I saw as well the other competitors with a lot of attitude. You know, I remember that they were there, Ronald y Alba, Alfredo y Andrea, and them four, they are fire on the stage. And they were fire at that time. It was 2012. And I was like, Sara, you didn't came here just to, you know, be shy. You have to go there and do whatever. And it was improvisation. So you have to show what you can do, but if you don't play with your attitude and your face, you're not gonna do nothing for sure, because they can do it and they can do it really well. And if you don't make the difference, you came for nothing. So it was like a conversation with myself. And at that moment there, behind on the stage, I was like, go and go for it, you know? And I, well, now I see that video and I say, oh my God. But at that time, it was really good for me as a transformation, you know? And we won. And it was like, oh my God, we didn't expect it at all. And from that moment, everyone, at least in Spain, knew who Marco and Sara were at the moment. Mm. So we were so happy. Like, we came to show something and we made it, you know? So that was good.
Mm. Yeah, sometimes it's the people in your own country that you are more scared to show than abroad and internationally. Mm. Yeah, I can really relate to that too. Like, sometimes it's the people in your own city that if that's going to make or break you, because how do you think that you can reach outside if you cannot, you know, even reach outside your city or make a name?
We say here in Spain that sometimes, I don't know how to translate, but let's say something like the people that will value the, not the most, the less.
The least, yeah.
Yeah, the least are the people around you, like in your city, in your country. And, you know, a lot, like, let's say, I don't know, 70 or 80% of the Bachata international artists, we are from Spain, and we work, I don't know, let's say, exaggerating 8 weekends a year in our country. And I'm exaggerating a lot. 8 years, yeah. So imagine, you know.
Yeah, it's crazy. But yeah. I guess that's a part of the journey. And once you got that over with, you could reach far. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. So now I'm gonna go into like a little bit more of a personal dive here, just as you. So just Sara Panero, from your perspective, you know, no excuses needed. Mm-hmm. What do you think that you have been, is there anything in your life that you've been chasing a lot in your life that you no longer want now?
You know, when I was younger, I was really worried about the people's opinion. And I think I'm not doing really much that now, and it's working so good. And I don't want again to feel that or to be worried every day about the people's opinion or, you know, anything in personal or professional. And I'm trying to change that, and I think I'm doing it. And I hope not to change again, because it's something that just stops you. It doesn't help you to do that.
Yeah. And when you've been growing as a person, what is the one thing that you're most proud of when it comes to your personal growth throughout these years?
To learn how to do the things by myself. It doesn't matter what. I'm a really independent person from really little, since, I don't know, 15, 16 years old, I started teaching. So from that moment, I was really proud, because I was like, I don't need my parents to give me money if I want to buy clothes or whatever, you know, obviously small things, but, you know, when I moved to Madrid as well, my parents were separate, were not together anymore. And, you know, I'm not from a rich family or something like that. I'm from a medium, you know, I don't know how to say in English.
Middle class. Media. Yeah.
Medium class. And, you know, I just learned by myself and watching as well my parents, that if you want something, you have to work for it. And if it's a gift, you're not gonna maybe, or if you don't have to put any effort to get something, maybe the feeling is not gonna be that good, you know? You have to work for something, and then when you get it, you know, you will feel so good than if you just get the things for free or not doing any effort, you know?
Yeah.
So till today, I'm applying that and I try to work on that with that mind, you know?
Yeah, it's like an entrepreneurial mind, making your own company, making your own, yeah. And what would you think, what would you say that people, what's the people's biggest misunderstanding about Sara Panero?
I think when I see some questions that people does nowadays, I think they see the person or the artist that I'm today, but they don't think or they don't realize how many things I passed through to arrive to this point, you know? And they think, I don't know, maybe in their minds they are like, oh, because, you know, I dance like her. For example, as an example, I just like her, but you know, she has a lot of more whatever, or she has this, or she has that. But I passed through a lot, personally, professionally. Everyone has a beginning, and mine was not easy. Like, I think 90% of the people, they can say they have passed through a lot. I did as well. I passed through a lot as well. And I can feel nowadays, you know, there is a lot of invite, there's a lot of like, always. And because if they will be interested or they will know the whole story, maybe they will think differently, you know. But I try to work on that mind of going forward and not look to the sides, don't look back, because that won't help me to my to achieve the goals that I have. So.
Yeah, no, but that's great. I think that is really important. That is one of the reasons I really want to do these interviews, because everyone has a story.
Yeah.
And it's so important to see like behind an artist, behind a dancer, whatever it is, school owner, organizer, whatever it is, there is a personal story. All of them are different.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing that. So I have put together like a little way to we can get to know you by you filling in the blanks. So basically I'm going to start a sentence and you, whatever you feel as you, Sara Panero, you are giving me the end. Okay. So for example, a great dancer is
complete.
Complete. Oh, okay. Great. Great. Okay. You get a hang of it.
Great training.
Okay. So I will continue. An inspiring performer on stage express
personality.
Nice. A great leader should make you feel
comfortable.
A great follower should show you
I don't know how to say it in English. In one word.
No, it doesn't have to be one word. You can next. A great follower should show you.
Smooth following. I don't have to express that. Like, I would say a good follower has always to wait for the guy and then put styling or musicality or whatever, but never interrupts the living. That's my feeling or my way of thinking.
Yeah, thank you. An organizer should treat their artists and crews
as a human being.
Yes, go for it, yes. An amazing event is
an amazing experience.
All right. Yeah. I think that, you know, if people want to, you know, pay Sara Panero for consulting what an great experience is, take your time now.
You know, in this quarantine, how many friends or people that I know called me to ask me, and I was like, what I'm now, like a consultant, you know? But, you know, I give my opinion. I don't want to make the people do things that they don't want. But, you know, sometimes I think what there is happening now, mostly in the quarantine now, is that people things come and appears, you know, or things just happen. Meanwhile, they are laying on like on the sofa, and it doesn't work like that at all, you know. They don't go for the things, they don't move, they don't opens new project, they don't, you know, think about, they just wait for the things, and obviously things appears by lucky one time over 100, I don't know.
Yeah. So. No, but you should maybe update your website to have like the dancer, the performer, the console, the event planner. Okay, the next one is, I have no tolerance for
machismo.
Sorry?
In Spanish, it's machismo.
Like macho?
Yeah.
Or no? Oh, okay.
When they treat you like, because you're a woman, you cannot do that, or because you're a woman, you cannot, you know, think or think about being more than, not more, but in aspirar a más cosas. No sé cómo se dice eso. My boyfriend is here like translating, but no. He's like, no, I don't understand. When they treat you like if they are more because you are a woman.
Mm. Sexist. Yeah. Okay, being a successful entrepreneur in the dance scene means
sacrifice.
Ooh. Mm-mm. Okay. Not having a great work ethic creates.
Repeat.
Not having a great work ethic creates. Mm-hmm.
Fracaso, fail. I would say fail. Like not be professional.
Mm.
Fail. Yeah.
Fail. Straight up.
The people. Yeah. Right. People not professional, they can, you know, have success or apparently success at the beginning, but the important or the difficult thing is not to arrive there, is to keep you on that, you know, on that place. And when you're not professional, you're not gonna make it.
Mm.
Yeah. Or you will work with people not professional as you. So.
All right. Yes. And the last one is to keep talent long term.
Never stop learning.
Booyaka. Awesome. Booyaka. Cool. All right, so I have a couple small questions also to kind of wrap up. Who is Sara Panero, not only on the dance floor, but if you could create a law that everyone in the world had to follow, what law would you create?
My woman is like, yeah, good question. A law. I would say to always experience what you do to the people. I mean, if you do something to someone good, to experience by yourself. If you do something bad, you experience by yourself. So that will, I think, or I think will evitar or avoid a lot of things that people does and don't think about the other.
Straight karma shots. Fast. All right. And what is one of the biggest lessons that you've learned this year? You know, this year haven't been that, have been very different from other years. So what has been one of your lessons, biggest lessons this year?
I will say two. One is obvious, but I think for me it was really something that I learned, that health is the most important thing. Doesn't matter what, like you can or things can change or stop at any moment. So as soon as you're healthy, it will be all right. In this quarantine, I also started thinking differently about, you know, how to treat my body or how to eat, you know, something that I couldn't focus on before because of the travels and all the stuff. And I'm really proud of that. And also, it's something that I already knew, but I'm experiencing even more in the quarantine, which is if you don't work for yourself or if you don't do it by yourself, anyone will do it. Like if you want to do something or create something or make it bigger, your brand, your work, whatever, you need to move your ass. Like you need to go and just try, because if you, for example, create, I don't know, online classes, let's say, will be always better to have 20 people than zero. If you have 100, it will be nice, perfect, amazing, but being doing nothing all day will give you anything. So, and I can't be doing anything, something that I can't do. It's like, I'm not nervous, but I can take one day of resting. But
you're looking sideways, so you're looking at your boyfriend.
He's only thing now, but it's really hard for me to stop working. I'm a workaholic, and I can, let's say, I can take one day off, but on the second one, I'm like, I need to do this, I need to do this, I need to, you know, I'm like that. So, and I did this year things that I didn't imagine, I didn't expect it to do. I didn't know or knew how it will work, and I'm so happy because I tried and I'm seeing a lot of results, and I learned a lot of things in this quarantine mainly. And every time I'm teaching, I'm learning something, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not that I'm teaching and I know more than you. No, I'm teaching, but I'm a student as well at the same time. And yeah. It changed a lot my mind as well of being here at home, or how much values my time as well. Yeah, it was everything, almost everything positive.
Yeah, that's great to hear. I think that is like what we need right now. It's inspiring stories, because a lot of people has had it like a rough time, losing everything, the jobs and everything. Mm-hmm. Was the online classes that you've been running, is that something that was the new part, or what has been one of your new things that you never tried before?
So, you know, for everyone is new, the online congresses, for example. I started, you know, doing kind of testing with friends, and after, you know, people saw that worked, and we were doing more and everything, and actually I thought, I think I have a lot of material to teach, so why I don't offer my own online weekender? And so I put the idea on the paper, and I thought, yeah, I can teach 5 hours and teach this and this and that and that. And after, you know, a Q&A and answering some questions of the girls or whatever, so I was like, I did 2 weeks of promotion, and my goal was, okay, if I can reach, I don't know, 50, 100 girls, it would be, you know, just amazing, because that means that the girls want to learn from me directly, because there's no more teachers, there's nothing. It's just my product, you know? And first, it served me a lot. For me, I learned so much. I took private classes. I prepared the classes a lot. Like, I don't remember when I was preparing the classes like that, actually, because, you know, it's a lot of responsibility. But it was amazing. The girls are so thankful. It was this weekend, it finished. It was Saturday and Sunday. And, you know, it was so great feeling. I felt so like that I accomplished my goal of arriving to a lot of girls. And to teach deeply the things that I believe on. You know, I was teaching musicality, I was teaching Dominican, I was teaching body movement, I was teaching posture. I was talking a little bit about the benefits of the ballet for the body and for any dance, anatomy, you know, a lot of different stuff that you don't have possibility to teach in festivals or online festivals, doesn't matter. So I was really happy.
so nice. And now you tried new things. And I kind of want to know, like, what is your vision now? Where are you going from here? And like, what would you like to see yourself accomplish, but also maybe changes within the scenes that you are in?
You know, this opened my mind in a way that we are used to go to the congresses and do these kind of classes. I believe people are really interested in a specific content, not just in a combination, you know? And that changed my mind on that. I will continue working online, even if the situation gets better or we go back to the normality. I don't know when, but I will definitely keep working online. Maybe not like now, but I won't stop, because you can arrive to a lot of people from your house. It's just amazing. And you know, my goal is now happening, but I just want to make it bigger, and it's inspire people and get like be known for my product, my style, my way of dancing. I'm not just a bachata dancer or kizomba dancer or salsa dancer. I'm a dancer in the Latin world, and I want the people to, you know, get interest on me, on my product. And you know, when people tells me I started dancing because I saw one video of yours or Mark and you or whatever, it makes me so happy. Is the best thing of the day. Always.
That is so beautiful. Thank you so much for that, because it's like, it's so inspiring to hear that, you know, now again, as you say, I think that this is a feeling you have as a follower, that, you know, you don't want to be a product of whoever you're dancing with. You just don't want to be a plus one. You want to know, you want to show what you have, and especially coming from a lot of different styles, you're like, but I have all of this. I don't just have one thing. Yeah. I have like all. And to be able to show that is amazing. So I'm really, really happy for you.
And you know, dance has been part of my life since I have memory. So, and it is my life, you know, and I recommend dance to everyone. Doesn't matter the age, doesn't matter the nothing, you know, dance is happiness. So I just want, with my work, with my passion, to arrive to as much people as I can and change their life, because I believe dance is, for me, the best thing can happen to you. So.
Yeah, it's the best, this the best sickness you can get is the addiction of dance.
Dance addict.
Yes. Well, you know, thank you so much for your time. You're thanks welcome. For sharing your story to the world. I kind of just want to leave the mic to you. If somewhere we can find you, something you want to promote, something you want to say to the people, the mic is yours.
Thank you. So I will say to the people, because this yesterday or 2 days ago, I got some questions, people asking me like if there is any age to start dancing, or if it's too late with, you know, old age, whatever it is, start dancing. And obviously, no, everyone can dance, everyone can start dancing. All the things that dance can give you are benefits. So if you were thinking about starting or not, just do it and you will feel the better sensations in your life, I think. And if you want to follow me, I have my Instagram and Facebook. Sara Panero in Instagram together and separated on Facebook. I also have now my website with my partner, marcoisara.com. We are giving online classes from there. You know, you have a calendar, so you can check when we are teaching. And I hope to see you around and hope that this situation passed soon and be able to share the times and the energy and the dance together as before.
Yes, that's amazing. Thank you so, so much. And I wish you a great day and I hope to see you soon on the next event somewhere in the world.
So.
All right, thank you so much.
You're welcome.